Hello, I'm Yael Broya, and welcome to Covering COVID-19 on Channel 7, where you find local programmes from the cities in our local TV network. We have stories on the Welsh Air Ambulance across England with Antiques Roadshow's Eric Knowles, creating innovative PPE for our frontline NHS in Liverpool, plus a local hero in Bristol, and good news regarding the lockdown from our special correspondent in Norway too. Liverpool has always been great at making things and building things. Great football teams being one. And you'll never walk alone has never seemed more appropriate. The NHS needs more PPE, we know, and one brilliant Liverpool-based company has found a way to create visors using 3D technology. Liverpool Local TV reports.
We started to hear that there was a real problem with personal protective equipment, PPE, initially for the NHS, hospitals, doctors, but also in the wider community. You know, you've got people going into homes for social care, you've got people starting to do food deliveries now, post these down the street and shop workers. So there's a huge demand for this. And that encompasses eye protection visors, predominantly for NHS professionals. There's also a huge need for face masks, gloves, gowns, you name it, people are shouting out for this stuff. But a 3D printer is kind of like a box with a print head that heats up, and you've got a filament of plastic that goes into it off a reel, and that melts the plastic, and then what happens is it moves around and it lays down that plastic in a line as a layer, and that cools rapidly and hardens, and then it goes up a tiny little bit and it lays down the next layer. And on and on and on until eventually you get this 3D shape. The problem is that it's quite slow. So various mask designs are taking between 1 and say 4 hours for a 3D printer to print. Now you can imagine, if we need a few thousand, we actually need tens of millions. Now a laser cut is basically a big flatbed and it's got a laser head that moves around it and it cuts whatever's underneath. And you can cut things out really rapidly and to a high degree of precision. So our laser cutters we use to cut woods and plastics and that kind of thing, lots of people for lots of different purposes. But in terms of PPE, one of my colleagues, Adrian McEwen, who is one of the founders and a director of Does Liverpool, he's been working to create a laser cuttable PPE visor design. So we've got that, that's open for anybody who wants to use it. Again, this is not a commercial activity, we're not making money here, just trying to help.
There has been a lot of discussion about how we can get out of lockdown in the UK. China is completely out now, and in Europe things are improving. Our correspondent in Norway, Tony Jackson, has been sending us daily reports and good news. Here's what he's been saying this week.
The good news is that our health minister has just announced that they have now officially got the virus under control. That is to say, that for every person that has got the virus or had the virus, they are only transmitting 0.1 person to somewhere else, to someone else. So that's excellent. Before it was 2.5. So that's very encouraging. So obviously they can't let up, but it's obviously going down now. So it's not by any means over, but we are seeing signs that things are starting to loosen up a little bit. The following points I'm going to make now were given to us yesterday by our Prime Minister, Arne Solberg. And the dates, the 20th and the 27th of April, are key here. On the 20th of April, kindergartens will be able to reopen. That'll be a great help, as there are a lot of parents that are able to go to work, obviously at the moment cannot go to work. Not everybody can work from home. On the 20th of April, people that own cabins up in the mountains and have cabins on the coast will be able to start using them again, which will be a great relief for very many. On the 27th of April, 6 to 9-year-olds will be going back to school. The reason they're stopping at 9-year-olds is because then these children can use the whole of a junior school, spreading out, spreading the load out, making more classrooms. There's plenty of available teachers for this. The older children, it's not such a problem because they obviously, as they're older, they can have most of their teaching through the net, via the net. So computers, iPads, etc. So they have a full school day at home. On the 27th of April, all businesses ordered to close during the outbreak can then reopen. We're talking about hairdressers, physiotherapists, and any other close contact institutions. Those that can work from home are asked to continue to do so. On the 15th of June, some sports and cultural events can reopen, but again under extremely strict control. These businesses and many other businesses will be entitled to 80% of lost earnings since the outbreak. And this will be fast-tracked as soon as possible.
Back in the UK, in Bristol, a local hero has been helping out the NHS.
Across the country, frontline NHS staff are making the difficult decision to live away from home to avoid exposing family members to COVID-19. And one Bristol homeowner offered up his property to be used for free by NHS staff for the duration of the pandemic.
On the eve of the coronavirus lockdown, I was seeing a lot of videos on Facebook and social media of doctors, nurses, medical staff having to self-isolate from their family, whether that be in a separate annex of their house or a garage or something, because they were really worried about treating patients and then bringing home coronavirus to their parents who may well be high risk. I was really keen to find a way to help. So what I did was move back home with my parents and put an ad on Facebook offering out my flat for free to any NHS staff that needed it for the duration of the lockdown. It's around Hawfield, so just off of Gloucester Road, so really close to Southmead, which is ideal. It was really great. I had two nurses take me up on the offer who moved in last week. They seem to be doing okay in there.
And when you put that post online, it sort of went viral, didn't it? You know, thousands of people saw the post. So you got a great reaction from it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think by the time I'd woken up in the morning, because I put it on as I'd come back after the lockdown announcement, it already had kind of 2,000, 3,000 shares, which was unbelievable. And what it meant is I had hundreds of doctors, nurses and medics reach out to me asking for a place to stay. It was great that I was able to help a couple of them, but what it was quite evident was that I couldn't help all of them. So I've really been trying to come up with a solution afterwards to help out the people that still needed to move away from their family and weren't necessarily able to.
Wow, wasn't that great? But that's not the whole story. Just wait and see what happened next. This is even more impressive.
You mentioned that you were sort of exploring ways to help all the thousands of other people that you didn't manage to help. What other things are you looking at doing?
So I've been trying to reach out to landlords, Airbnb owners, anyone with a spare room that may be willing to let it out to NHS staff. Obviously, the nature of house lettings, most people will usually let their properties for 6 months, which might not be an ideal timescale for medical staff that might only want to move out for the short term to protect their families. So I've had kind of an overwhelming response back from a lot of landlords, Airbnb owners that have been willing to offer it out to NHS staff at a discount. So since I've moved the two nurses in, I've managed to kind of house four or five other nurses, medical staff for free in some properties, and also put all of the rest in touch with a lot of landlords that are willing to change the average tenancy and also offer some discounts to the staff, which is great.
And I guess there's a lot of people doing just what you did, you know, sort of escaping back to the country. I know if I wasn't, you know, a reporter in Bristol, I'd be, you know, heading up the M5 to the Midlands, where to my mum and dad's place. So I'm guessing there's a lot of city centre apartments, flats, which are standing empty right now, which could be used by medical professionals should they need it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think because it's still in the early days of the crisis and everyone's kind of making sure them and their families are safe and waiting for the dust to settle, I don't think it's really been flagged up as an issue. So people haven't necessarily thought about it. But yeah, you're right. There's going to be a lot of vacant properties that could be used to house NHS staff and things like university accommodation. If they're sat dormant for university students at the start of next term, There's plenty of opportunities for places for these staff to stay.
That's it for part one. More heartwarming stuff in part two, and boy, do we need it. Hello, I'm Yael Broya, and welcome back to Covering COVID-19 from Channel 7, where you find local programs from the cities on the local television network. So many people have been doing so much to help others. He wouldn't say that, but Eric Knowles from the Antique Roadshow is one such. Mark Walker at Latest TV Brighton spoke to Eric about what he's up to.
I know you're doing something very special for the British Red Cross, and it's going to involve your expertise.
Well, that's right. It's all to do, obviously, with COVID-19, and basically, I'm trying to avoid going bonkers because you know, I'm one of these people. I can't sit still, and so I decided that what I would do is that I would produce a series of talks, like tutorials, not lectures. And I'm going to be covering lots of subjects which I normally do actually lecture on. And so at the moment, I'm recording pieces about René Lalique, and I've just completed one about his jewellery. I'm working on Lalique glass perfume bottles, parts one and two. And then I'll just go through it and do vases. Then I'll probably do sculpture and car mascots. And then I'll go on to something completely different.
People are spending more time at home at the moment during the coronavirus crisis. Obviously, they're self-isolating a lot of people. So these are going to be welcome talks, aren't they?
Well, hopefully. I mean, what TV that I do, I don't often get the opportunity to go into the sort of detail which I personally find fascinating that I would like to.
Do you find it easier to talk online than to members of the public, people that bring in their kind of antiques, or what are the differences and similarities?
Well, I've ad-libbed my way through life so far, and nobody's found me out. That's the way I look at it. But I can say that it's much easier when I've got an audience. You know, I'd like to establish a rapport immediately with an audience. It's a bit weird talking to a little green dot at the top of your Apple Mac, and consequently, I'm getting there. But I'm, you know, it's a bit of a challenge.
And the British Red Cross, of course, they do excellent work, don't they?
Well, the British Red Cross, yes, of course, and that's where we're asking people to channel the funds to the British Red Cross, and they will make sure that it gets to all the right people. I mean, well, obviously, we're looking at anything that we can do, or I can do. You know, I just want to sit at home like an innocent bystander. That's what prompted me to make the effort and just to see if this is something that people are going to be interested in. And if we can just raise, even if it's just, you know, a donation of £1 after each one, if I can reach out to people and if they can be kind enough just to take £1 out of their pocket and send it off to the Red Cross, hopefully we can do some good.
Nice to hear that from Eric. Now, Welsh Air Ambulance are set up to help others. Let's hear now what they're doing to help. Luke Davies from Local TV Cardiff reports.
With coronavirus affecting all areas of society, we learn about how one of the most critical charities in the country is being helped to keep flying.
The medical service is running as normal. We will be guided by NHS Wales. It's the best use of our resources and medics. In terms of the charitable operation, that's a little bit more difficult, and that's become a little bit more challenging. A lot of our events would be public-facing. The challenge events, the bucket collections and so on have all quite rightly had to be cancelled. However, we are looking at alternative ways, and obviously online fundraising is the area that we're predominantly doing a lot of our work now to try and maintain our funds through for the next few weeks and months.
How have people responded? Are people still eager to you know, give thanks and to give their show their support in any way they can? Or
do you know, one thing about situations like this where there's adversity, it really does bring out the best in people. We've had a phenomenal amount of support from the Welsh public through heartwarming messages, but also they've been generous in terms of supporting our emergency appeal, which we've set up again to make sure that we can maintain the service through donations.
Not only have the public been kind enough to support yourselves, but I understand that BP have done something quite kind as well. Tell us a bit about that, please.
Our Davern base receives their fuel supplies from a division of BP called Air BP. They very kindly said that they would give fuel to us for free at least until the end of April. And these are the types of gestures that are going to allow our service to continue. The key thing to say that this is a virus, it doesn't discriminate against people, and it can affect people at all ages, regardless of their health. And I think that's a key point to get across. And the only way we can do that is to follow the appropriate guidance that we've been given.
We've been hearing quarantine songs on this programme, but now something a bit different. The most heartwarming global video we've seen so far. Well done, Lizzie and the Trigmen. I wish I'd known about this earlier. I would have loved to dance in this video, feathers and all. But for now, it's goodbye from me. See you next time.
Let's see. How does this work? Ooh, okay.
All gatherings for purposes of entertainment and amusement are prohibited until further notice. People are earnestly requested not to crowd together unnecessarily in any circumstances.
Hey, have you heard the news? The world's about to end and we got nothing to lose. 5 minutes left and we'll all be toast. So let's toast. Hey, it's a perfect day to gather all your troubles and just throw them away. There's nothing left to do, my friend, believe.